Morgan Stanley's New York office asked this question in a recent first round interview. Walk me through a DCF. For those who are not familiar, DCF stands for discounted cash flow. This is one of the most popular topics that investment bankers like to test candidates on during interviews because there are a lot of different concepts they can test for when it comes to the DCF. For example, you have to know 1, how to calculate free cash flow, 2, how to calculate terminal value, 3, how to calculate the discount rate, also known as WACC or weighted average cost of capital, and 4, how to calculate cost of equity, which includes things like CAPM and beta. So when a banker asks you to walk them through a DCF, it's really a question with a bunch of different concepts all rolled up into one. And that's what makes it tricky. But don't worry, because in this video, we're gonna walk you through how a DCF works, and we're gonna do it in a way that's so simple, even a sixth grader could understand it. And once you understand it, you won't have to memorize this answer by brute force, because memorizing answers doesn't work, since your interviewers can always change how they ask the question, and they're almost never going to ask the exact question you happen to memorize. I can guarantee you that. Now, if you're new here, I'm Sam, a former technology investment banker at Morgan Stanley. Today, I run Wall Street Mastermind, where we've helped over 1,300 students who have collectively secured offers from every single bulge bracket and elite boutique investment bank on Wall Street. Now, with that said, let's dive in and help you understand how a DCF works once and for all. First things first, what is a DCF? Simply put, a DCF is a way to value a business or figure out how much it's worth. And the way this is done is by calculating all the future cash flows that it will generate and then discounting it back to present value. Now, what does it mean to discount something back to its present value? Well, let's say I want to give you some money and I want to give you two options to choose from. For option number one, I will give you $100 today. For option number two, I will give you $10 a year for the next 10 years. Now, in both options, I'm giving you $100 in total. So which option would you prefer? Well, most people would choose to have $100 today, of course, right? But why? Well, the answer has to do with a concept called the time value of money, which basically states that a dollar today is worth more than a dollar tomorrow. So let's look at why that's the case, right? If you go with option number one and you took $100 today, you can go and invest that $100 and earn a return on it. So let's assume you pick something very safe and you just put it in the bank and just earn a very low interest rate of just 2% a year. After year one, your $100 would be worth $102. After year two, your $102 will become $104.04. After year three, it grows to $106.12. And so on and so forth. At the beginning of year 10, you would have gotten $121.90. So that's option number one. Now, if you had gone with option number two, by the beginning of year 10, you would have just gotten your final payment of $10, right? And at this point, you would only have $100, which is less than the $121.90 that you would have gotten in option one. So if you stay with this logic, it begs the reason that the cash flows you will receive in the future are worth less than cash flows you can receive today. Right? And the further out the cash flow is, the less that cash flow is worth as well. So $100 today is worth more than $100 a year from now. And $100 a year from now is worth more than $100 2 years from now, because the earlier you get that cash, the earlier you can invest it and the more you can grow that money. So this is why when you value a business using a DCF, you have to take all of their future cash flows and discount each cash flow back to its present value, which is just a fancy way of saying how much would that cash flow be worth today. Then you add up all of the present and values of each future cash flow that's coming in, and that gives you the enterprise value of the business, or in other words, how much the business is worth. So that's how a DCF works conceptually. When you're actually doing a DCF, you will typically project out the free cash flow of the business for the next 5 to 10 years. You want to project out the cash flows until the business reaches steady state, okay, which means the business is growing at a stable and predictable rate and is now a mature business. More on this in a bit when we talk about the terminal value. Now, at the same time, you typically don't want to go more than 10 years, because the further out you have to make projections, the harder it becomes to be accurate with your projections. But what is this free cash flow number that you're projecting anyway? Well, conceptually, when a business sells something and generates cash, there's a few different uses for that cash. Some of the cash will be used to pay your employee salaries or pay for the office rent, plus any other expenses needed to operate the business. And since we're calculating the actual cash that's flowing into or out of the business, we want to make sure to only include actual cash expenses while leaving out non-cash expenses like depreciation and amortization. Some of the cash will also be used to pay for taxes because, you know, the government is going to make sure they get theirs. And some of the cash might be used to pay for working capital, or in other words, the day-to-day expenses of the business. So for example, you have to pay for inventory so that you have something to sell. You have to pay for invoices that you owe your vendors, also known as accounts payable. And you have to keep the lights on while you're waiting to be paid by your customers, also known as accounts receivable. So all of these items require cash, and this is what working capital means. Last but not least, some of the cash will be reinvested back into the business. For example, example, by purchasing new equipment, which is also known as CapEx or capital expenditures. Now, once all of that is taken care of, any remaining cash can then go to the company's investors. And that's how you derive the free cash flow formula. And this free cash flow is what helps determine what the company is worth from the investor's point of view, because this is the cash that they can get their hands on. For example, if you invest in the equity of the business, which means you own a percentage of the business, the free cash flow can be paid out to you in the form of dividends. On the other hand, if you invest it in the debt of the business, the free cash flow can be used to pay you interest and also repay the original principal that you loaned the business, right? So that's why if you take the future free cash flow of the business and you discount these cash flows back to their present value, you can calculate how much this business is worth to its investors. But okay, now that we understand that, you might be wondering, what about the cash flows generated by the business after those first 5 to 10 years of your projection period? Well, this is a great question because that's where the terminal value comes in. The terminal value is basically an approximation of all the future cash flows of the business beyond the first 5 to 10 years. Once it's reached its steady state and has become a mature business, this will usually represent 60 to 80% of the company's value. Now, we use this approximation because it would be silly to try to forecast what will happen that far out into the future with any sort of accuracy, right? So instead, we have two ways to calculate the terminal value. The first is the exit multiple method, where you apply a reasonable multiple to the last year of the forecast period, usually using a measure of profit such as EBIT or EBITDA, right? For example, if the company's EBITDA, which stands for earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization, by the way, but if your company's EBITDA is $100 million in year 10, and the EBITDA multiple for similar companies is, let's say, 10 times, then the terminal value would be 100 million times 10, which is $1 billion. And then you would then discount the $1 billion by 10 years to get back to its present value today. And we'll talk about how to do discounting in a second here. Now, this is typically the more practical way to do it, okay? And it's what most investment bankers do when they need to calculate the terminal value. Now, the other method is the Gordon growth method, right? Which is also known as the perpetuity growth method. This one is more academic in nature, but basically there's a formula that says terminal value equals the free cash flow in the last year times 1 plus the long-term growth rate. And then you take all of that and you divide it by the denominator, which is the weighted average cost of capital minus the long-term growth rate. For the sake of keeping the length of this video concise, I will try to create a separate video to cover this in more detail in the near future. But for now, just know that you should get to roughly similar terminal value figures using these two methodologies. They won't be exactly the same, but they should give you an approximate range for what the terminal value would reasonably be. So you can use both methods at the same time if you want to kind of triangulate and make sure that the number that you get to is within the right ballpark. You have your free cash flow, right, for the first 5 to 10 years projected out. You have your terminal value that represents all of the future cash flows beyond that initial 5 to 10 year projection period. All you have to do is discount all these cash flows back to the present value. And so for that, you can use the present value formula, which states that present value is equal to the future value divided by the denominator, which is 1 plus the discount rate to the number of periods. So for example, let's say a company has a 10% discount rate and you expect future cash flows to be $10 in year 1, $10 in year 2, and $20 in year 3. So in this case, the present value of the year 1 cash flow would be calculated as $10 divided by 1 plus 10% all in parens to the first power, because it's year 1. You're only discounting it back 1 year, right? And so that gives you $10 divided by 1.1, which gets you to $9.09. So the present value of your first year's cash flow is $9.09. Now, the present value of the year 2 cash flow would be calculated as $10 divided by the denominator, which is 1 plus 10%, in other words, 1.1 to the second power, because you're discounting it back by 2 years, right? And so $10 divided by 1.21 equals $8.26. So the $10 in year one was only worth $9.09 in today's value. And then the $10 in year two, because even though it's the same amount, you're getting it 1 whole year later, this time that $10 is only worth $8.26 in today's value, right? And so that year two cash flow is worth less than the year one cash flow. Now, the present value of the year three cash flow would be calculated as $20 in the numerator, because we're getting $20 of cash, divided by the denominator, which is 1 plus, again, 10% discount rate, so 1.1 to the third power, because you're discounting this cash flow back by 3 years. $20 divided by 1.33 is about $15.04. Okay, so the total present value of the next 3 years' cash flows would be $9.09 plus $8.26 plus $15.04, which gets you to a total of $32.30. $0.39, which is less than the $40 you would get if you just added $10 plus $10 plus $20. In other words, getting the three payments that add up to $40 over 3 years is just as good as getting $32.39 today immediately, assuming you can invest that money today and earn a 10% annual return on your money. And that basically explains what the discount rate represents. It's the return your investors would expect to get if they were to invest their capital elsewhere instead of investing it in the business that we're trying to value. In other words, it's the opportunity cost that they're foregoing, which is why we use it as the discount rate to discount our future cash flows back to their present values to figure out how much would this money be worth to the investor today. So this discount rate that we're using, the 10% in this example, is calculated using what we call WACC, which stands for weighted average cost of capital. Now, similar to the terminal value, there's a lot that goes into calculating the WACC, and it deserves its own separate video, which I will try to create again in the near future. But for now, you have a high level understanding of how a discounted cash flow works. So the next time you get asked this question in an interview, hopefully you'll ace it. Now, if you would like more hands-on and personalized coaching with your investment banking or private equity interviews from our team of coaches, that includes the former global heads of recruiting at top investment banks like Goldman Sachs, Credit Suisse, UBS, and Lehman Brothers, then please don't hesitate to reach out to our team. Oh, and this is one of our first videos breaking down the most commonly asked technical interview questions. So if you found this video to be valuable, please hit the like, subscribe, and share button so that we know to make more videos like this for you in the near future. And as always, remember, nothing worthwhile comes easy, and nothing is more important than your future. So keep grinding.